being realm in order to our stinking goals. Got my Scooby shirt on, yeah? My boy Tyrion laying on the world of late antiquity and through the eye. Oh, look, he's stretching. Oh, here he is. Oh, yeah. Oh, he's an adorable little boy. Yeah, adorable little boy. I need my keyboard though, Tyrion. What are you doing? He likes a nice, vigorous, like, nose rub. Step one, you know, tune her up. See if anything's out of tune here. We're in tune. There's a cool scene. Actually, that's what I'll talk about. There's some cool scenes of contrast in Better Call Saul. If you've watched that show, if you're a fan of Breaking Bad, Better Call Saul. There's some cool scenes involving guitars there. I haven't really seen anybody draw the distinction. Let me see if I can go find it as I talk about it. Watch later. Oh, this is the tightest shit you've ever seen in your entire life. Hold on. This is the tightest shit you've ever seen in your entire life. Don't deny. Watch. The tightest shit you've ever seen in your entire life. Intergalactic planetary! Proof you can look literally any way and be a genius. So to give you some context, there's some scenes in Better Call Saul where Saul's playing guitar and then somebody else is playing guitar. The father, one of the lawyers, and the father of the other lawyer. And of course, Saul's just full of himself and his own ego, and he sounds like ass even though he's playing like the easiest thing that they've taught beginners for like the past few decades at this point. When did Smoke on the Water come out? I don't practice it, but I think it goes like this. You can make it more spicy with some power chords. Well, Saul's playing that. It just sounds like ass. You know, there's a scene, I swear to God, there's a scene in the show where there's at least two guitar scenes with Saul in the show. One, he's playing Smoke on the Water, I think on a sofa, and the room's kind of dark and he just looks full of himself and his ego. And then there's another one where he's like laying on the ground, plucking, and also doesn't sound very good. And what's her face? His love interest, what's her name? Kim Wexler or something? Yeah, she comes in and is like, what the hell are you doing, Saul? You know, you're not swagging on the guitar. You're a petty troll sort of thing, you know? But then anyways, it's an interesting contrast because they show another scene where the father, the lawyer father of the other lawyer is playing guitar. This guy right here. And he's just playing the slow stuff, you know?
Kettleman's here with his wife.
Just working on, if you look at his technique, he's just working on a basic chord and a hammer-on and a pull-off while holding that chord shape. Right there, I think that might be D major. I don't know. It looks like D major to me, hold on. And he does a hammer-on and pull-off with his index finger. Here's the D major chord that I think he's playing. I'm still not quite there. I haven't really practiced this chord a lot. I focused mostly on E minor, up to this G major, but without the pinky, because it's been taking me 5 years to get the pinky down. I guess my point is, the like five or whatever chord shapes that are the most basic chord shapes that they always teach are basically all you need to master in order to play like endless guitar music. So I don't know, I focused on the key of E minor. Don't worry too much about music theory. I just picked the easiest key that made the most sense, given you have an E string here, and an E string here, and every single string in the standard tuning of guitar is a note that's within the key of E minor. So, which is also the key of G major, which, you know, so here's the G major chord. So I started with E minor. So you can start off holding the chord shape, and it'll teach you these chords. You know, so the key of E minor chords, you have E minor. You've got A minor, C major, D major, G major, B minor, and then this weird chord shape. I forgot if it's like F sharp suspended or something. And then the guitar book, chord book I had once upon a time, wanted me to do this chord right here. And then they were telling you to go use your pinky to get all the way the fuck up to that same F sharp note, but up here. And that felt impossible, but now I can do it. That felt impossible. Because, as you will come to realize, getting your pinky to do this while your ring finger is way the hell over here feels impossible. But I just kept trying and trying to get the stretch. And I guess I'll skip ahead a little. I know this isn't too good of a video in terms of the angle. I'll do better videos someday on my channel, Radio Ren. But I watch guitar advice and videos and stuff mostly for insight and not so much technical details. I'll get to the technical details eventually. But the insight is this contrast of your approach towards guitar and Better Call Saul. Saul's always an ego trying to be cool, and he never sounds cool. But this guy's working on some simple sauce, and you can tell he just has the right attitude, right? But this guy works on the simple sauce, you can tell he has the right attitude. Not trying to do anything cool, he's just mastering those basic chord shapes. He's not playing fast or anything.
Hey, do you have a sec?
Of course, what's up?
Right, and he's just knocking it out in some free time, practicing a little something before he has to go back to work or whatever. What was I talking about, though? Yeah, he was working on, I think, a D major chord. In the beginning, it's hard enough just to hold the chord shape, but as it gets easier and easier just to hold the chord shape, you'll find that the fingers get more and more independence, and you can eventually lift one finger up at a time while the others stay put. I can even fret that G note, Hendrix style at this point. So, make a long story short, you only need to learn the basics on guitar. Get all your basic open position chord shapes second natured. That it's hard enough, trust me. It's hard enough. And then, in addition to that, I showed you all the chords. And by the way, let me add, I don't have them totally second natured yet. You're not going to hear the guitar. I'm not recording it, but I don't even have it totally second natured yet. But it's getting quicker and quicker. It's improving faster and faster. I think I'm through the worst part of the training on finger conditioning. My fingers felt dead when I started. Lumping and inert. It's like nothing existed down here. It's crazy. I learned all the chords in the key of E minor, which is all the same chords that are in the key of G major. Any musical key you learn in music, any minor key is always going to be a major key, and every major key also includes a minor key, and actually every key includes all the modes. Don't worry about the theory too much. I'm not so much a theory guy. I'm more just go do the techniques until they feel easy, and then it's endless exploration. But then the other thing, other than the open position chords, you need to master those and not worry too much about finger independence. It's hard enough to have your fingers stand in the chord shape, let alone do all the dexterous stuff. But you gotta make it easy one step at a time, right? You gotta be able to just hold the chord shape for really long periods of time. And as it gets easier, the fingers condition, you'll find you can wiggle your fingers a little bit more in that chord shape and then eventually lift them up. Tom Morello's masterclass, I think he was holding the A minor chord shape. You know, Tom Morello, Rage Against the Machine, and then he talked about getting that mosquito sound. Thank you. still coming through a little on all on the other fingers. It's easiest with your index in the beginning and feels next to impossible with the other three fingers. Just relax. In addition to the basic chord shapes, all you gotta do is work on basic fretting. A lot of people worry too much about hammer-ons and pull-offs in the beginning. Still cleaning it up. That's been 5 years in the making. Don't even worry about that, yo. Whenever I got frustrated with hammer-ons and pull-offs, I just go back to practicing my basic fretting technique into asking if that's truly where it needs to be, and more often than not, it's not. Until it's easy to fret this way. You need to be able to do that. And then slowly you'll add a little hammer-on and pull-off. For me, it's the progression is fretting, hammer-ons, then pull-offs. You master fretting. Once that's super easy, you just fret a little quicker and a little harder, perhaps, and you get a hammer-on. But I'll add here, quicker and harder. You don't need to do it much harder, but as you'll learn, because you have no fine motor control, when you try to do it, you're going to do it way too hard, and it's going to feel frustrating. It's just lots and lots of repetition of the exercises to develop the muscle and neuronal control or the nervous signal and all that to get the fine motor control to hammer on at precisely the amount of force you need. But you start off doing it too hard in the beginning, which is fine. Just be patient, work on fretting. But then the other thing I was gonna say is when I say you just fret faster, I don't mean like you play in a higher BPM, like that's not what I mean. I mean, like, the moment when you actually decide to fret, that's what's deceptive about the speed thing. I could be playing very slow, and you can't hear the guitar, I know, but you could be playing something slow. But the moment at which you actually decide to fret needs to be timed right and very quick. Even if you're playing something slow, it's weird. I'll talk about that more in the future. My cat laying on my mouse, and it disconnects every time he does. Tiri! So the easier and more second nature and precise and accurate you make your fretting, the more you'll start to easily kind of maybe even accidentally do a hammer-on from time to time. And then the easier your hammer-on gets, the easier it'll be to kind of pull off gently and get a little pull-off sound. So that's my point with this video. But and the Better Call Saul thing, philosophy of practice, you know. Saul's always racing on ego shit in his mind, and this other guy is more of a humble lawyer type. You know, concerned about something other than himself, other than, you know, unlike Saul most of the time. I guess I'll mention, you know, genius, yo. Hungarians, genius. This guy, this author. I'm part Hungarian, by the way. Geniuses, country of geniuses, these Hungarians, yo. Yeah, that Rubik's Cube guy invented it. Hungarian genius. While we're at it, let's go look up Hungarian geniuses, yo. Hungarian geniuses. Oh, look them up, yeah. How many, Quora, look at this. How did Hungary produce so many notable intellectuals? Maybe because it's a whole country of geniuses. Famous Hungarian inventions. Let's click on that. My chucklehead friends in high school used to be like, hey Colt, because they know I was Hungarian. Hey Colt, guess what? Hungary didn't do shit in World War II. They were always trolling me because I'm a World War II buff, and they, Hungary didn't do shit in World War II. No, read a book. Read Anthony Beaver's Second World War history. You don't know nothing. Hungary, Germany didn't do shit in World War II. Why? They didn't respect their allies. Why did the Romanian flanks collapse? Because the Romanians didn't have any anti-tank guns. Soviets had shitloads of tanks. What are you gonna do? Get machine gunned by tanks? You don't have any anti-tank guns. Because Germany kept all the best equipment for the Germans, and their allies everywhere saw this. The Italians saw it. They're like, gee, the Germans have anti-tank guns and modern rifles, but we don't. The Romanians saw it. Hey, gee, the Germans have the anti-tank guns, but we don't. And the Hungarians saw it. Read a book. Germany didn't do shit in World War II because they didn't didn't respect their allies, they lost the war. Had they respected their allies and tweaked their strategy, would have been a cakewalk. All Germany had to do was mass produce modern infantry equipment for their allies. Read a book. In North Africa, what killed the most British tanks were anti-tank guns used by infantry, concealed anti-tank guns. Wasn't even other tanks that killed the most tanks. Anti-tank guns. So it stands to reason, if Germany shifted its production emphasis onto modernized infantry equipment, and especially the support guns, the anti-tank guns and stuff, and gave those to all the Italians, Romanians, Hungarians, they'd have been way more effective. Read a book. Antony Beevor's The Second World War. He actually said in the chapter on Battle of Budapest and when the war got to Hungary, he said the Hungarians were very brave. Said they fought to the last man and to the last bullet more often than not. Where's the author's name, though? Oh, you can barely see it. Mihai Csikszentmihalyi. It's a hilarious name, yeah. Mihai Csikszentmihalyi. Think about it. God rest him. Rest in peace, Mihai Csikszentmihalyi. Well, he wrote three books. I read all three of them. Flow, The Evolving Self, and Creativity. I read all three of them. I can recommend all three. Oh, but wait. We're getting ahead of ourselves. We were going to go look at a list of Hungarian genius inventions. Famous Hungarian inventions. Tiny country, so keep that in mind, yo. Rubik's Cube. Genius invention. Ballpoint pen. Where would the world be without those? Vitamin C. Wasn't until 1930s that Hungarian scientist Albert, I don't know how to say Hungarian names, discovered the chemical ascorbic acid, also known as vitamin C. Well, I guess he didn't invent it. It must have been in the foods, but he discovered it. Electric locomotive. High voltage motors and generators. Can't say the name. Kalman Kando. Sounds like a Star Wars name or something. Who was also known as the father of electric locomotives. His work on railway electrification was essential to the birth of today's electric train. Where the hell would we be without electric trains? Genius country. Carbonated water. Plenty of people like their mineral water. Where would they be without this invention? Words and Excel. Holy shit, the whole modern office. Bookkeeping, record-keeping, accounting world relies on this. Hungarian-born computer programmer. Prezi, now we're getting a little modern here. Safety match, holography. What? Making unique photographic image. Invented by a Hungarian engineer. Color television. Tungsten lamps. Just to name a few. You know, Alan Watts said, when you know what you're doing, any book is zen. See if we know what we're doing today. Here's a good one. He says, people become so involved in what they are doing that the activity becomes spontaneous, almost automatic. They stop being aware of themselves as separate from the actions they are performing. A dancer describes how it feels when a performance is going well. Your concentration is very complete. Your mind isn't wandering. You are not thinking of something else. You are totally involved in what you are doing. Your energy is flowing very smoothly. You feel relaxed, comfortable, and energetic. People think this is beyond them, but they only think that regarding activities they don't have any proficiency in. Truth of the fact is, you flow all the time, it's just you never notice when you do because your mind isn't there. If you're an athletic type and you like basketball and soccer, chances are, when you go play a game of pickup, you don't think too much because you're just having fun. Just playing the game, you start flowing. You play your favorite sport, you realize you're flowing because you're just having fun. You don't gotta think about it, you just play. That's real hard on guitar in the beginning when you don't have any finger dexterity and everything feels like a fucking million tedious decisions in the beginning. But you get more and more, little bit more and more taste of flow as time goes on. I have to practice guitar like 2-4 hours a day before I really feel like I can sauce on something simple. Until then, I'm still warming shit up. It's getting there. There will be a day within the next 5 years where Colt, I can guarantee you, where Colt will blow your mind on guitar. But he's not in a rush, and that's not what it's all about anyways. So you only feel like you can't flow when you're incompetent in an activity, is what I'm saying. But the more you actually practice it and just deal with the discomfort of it feeling tedious as fuck, the easier it gets and the more it'll start to feel automatic, and then your mental thinking will shift to a higher order of something. In the beginning, you really gotta like hyperfixate on how the finger feels fretting the string, how the angle of everything is, etc. Constantly relaxing your million tedious decisions. Once it gets a little easy though, and you can kind of play 2 or 3 chords or whatever, you shift your thinking to how to time the chords so that you can develop the expression, how you play it expressively and all that stuff like that. You know, how long you play the chord, what kind of pattern you're playing, your thinking goes to a higher order after you pull it out of that through practice, after you stop needing to hyper focus on the little tedious details. Let's take a look at this Carlos Trepat. I don't know how to say it, Spanish dude, older dude. When I was 5 years ago picking up the guitar, I found this video and I told myself, by this guy's age, yo, if I could play even half as good as this, all of the effort that will go into guitar will be worth it. He's playing a guitar here from constructed in 1892. That's crazy. Looks so deceptively easy, like right here. He's got really good pinky ring finger independence. He does pinky hammer-ons and pull-offs pretty good too if you watch through this video. Like right here, see that? You got really good pinky ring finger independence. I train those two fingers more than all the other fingers. I train these three fingers the most since this one's already easy to kind of move quickly anyways. Right there. People are worried about the independence, but you also can just work them together is how you start. You worry less about the independence, just work all the fingers, get everything feeling strong and good again. Well, anyways, I like this guy. I go back to him every now and then. I'd love to be able to play classical guitar, Spanish style guitar, etc. like this someday. So I told myself, if I can play even half as good as this by this guy's age, then I'm gonna just keep practicing guitar because it will all be worth it, and you should too. Another funny memory on that note is the hobby story. Yo, I got interested in these games called Hearts of Iron. I'll go pull up images while I'm... World War II games, yo, the OG World War II game that is like every World War II's nerd. Every World War II nerd's like... fucking wet dream of a World War II game. Let's check it out. This Hearts of Iron game was introduced to me by, I think it was mostly Kenny from Alternate Universe and Chaos Games of More, and maybe Greg also played it. I remember geeking out with Kenny and Greg about Hearts of Iron. It's like just the ultimate wet dream. I was playing Hearts of Iron 3 a lot in Japan. I don't know, because I was in Japan, so I thought about World War II a lot. Yo, hold on. My favorite one's Hearts of Iron 3. I look at the new one, and I don't know, it looks a little too video gamey to me. I like how this one looks a little bit more inspired by like the era as far as its aesthetic goes. The new one just looks more like a digital video game or something. I don't know, aesthetically, I'll talk about it later. But I played Hearts of Iron games and World War II, my homie Bryce in Japan always saw me playing this and was like, Jesus, Colton, you need a PhD to play this game. And I was like, you're not far from the truth, yo. You're not far from the truth. These Hearts of Iron games, why did I bring that up? Oh, Kenny, that's why. It was my high school buddies who was always saying Germany didn't, or Hungary didn't do shit in World War II. And then I'm always playing up my Hungarian ancestry and I go to Kenny, I'm like, Austro-Hungarian Empire, Kenny, what do you say to that? And he's like, no, Colt, I think the Austrians were the dominant power in that whole thing. I'm like, where do I gotta go to see the greatness of Hungarians? What era of history, yeah? Greatest era of Hungarian history. Where do I gotta go? I always get this. Matthias Corvinus, one of Hungary's most glorious eras, was the time of the Hunyadis? Hunyadis? I don't know how to say it. In which Matthias Corvinus, the righteous, reigned as the greatest Hungarian king ever, leading Hungary to become one of the most important Central European countries. Let's take a look at this. We gotta go to find the Hungarian greatness in history, yeah? Brief history, gotta go to this Matthias Corvinus, I guess. So the Ottomans conquered the country? You know, the Turks, Ottomans. Hungarians revolt against the Austrian Emperor. Fucking Russia came in and helped. That's not fair. Hungary didn't do shit. What are you talking about? Russia came in and helped fucking the Habsburgs crush the Hungarians? You could only fight so much, yo. Hungarians are the greatest ever, yo. All they say about their greatest era is this area. Let's go look up Matthias Corvinus. Look at this badass. Jesus Christ. Fucking G, yo. Look at that. That's Colt's ancestor, yo. Guarantee it. Guarantee it, yo. Look at the resemblance, yo. Look at the resemblance, yo. Guarantee you I'm related to this dude. Guarantee it. Guarantee it. Guarantee it. Look at him. What'd he do, yo? Was he a brute or was he all right? Usually they're a bit of both. King of Hungary and Croatia. What a G. Oh my gosh, what a G, yo. After several military, he's elected king of Bohemia. Where's that? Isn't that in Germany? Where the fuck's Bohemia at? Habsburg, is it in Austria? Where the hell is Bohemia? Holy Roman Empire, you know, back then. Because nationalistic... I think this definitely predates the formation of Germany as like a stable country. I don't know. I gotta go freshen up my history. Look at this badass. Holy shit. Look, Colt's great, 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 great grandfather. Yo, there he is. Looking like a badass. Jesus. All right. Waged wars against Czech mercenaries. Fought fucking the Holy Roman Emperor. Signs a peace with the Holy Roman Empire because the Turks are moving in. He soon realized he could expect no substantial aid from the Christian powers and gave up his anti-Ottoman policy. That's interesting. You know, in our society, everybody always talks about shit as if it's the biggest deal ever. Take the Persian invasions of Greece. Once upon a time, they said, oh, Western society hung in the balance. If the Greeks lose, no Western society. I find that a little. The Persians would have turned Greece into a satrapy and exacted some tribute, but otherwise I still think there would have been a lot of Greek thought and thinkers and stuff. You know, we tend to want to really be tribal and see it all as these big showdowns, and one of those places where people do it is, they say all of Christendom would have fallen if the Turks kept winning, and it's like, probably not, yo. Every empire gets pretty big and then it gets harder to maintain the empire, and you never really can suppress all the other ideas and peoples and all that stuff. So probably not. I don't know anything about that, though. The Ottoman Empire moving into Europe and all those wars and stuff. I don't know anything about that. I don't know anything about my Hungarian history. He regularly set taxation at extraordinary levels. Oh no, Matthias. Don't tax them. Caused a rebellion in Transylvania, but he subdued the rebels. He declared another war on somebody in Bohemia. He eventually went back to war against the Ottomans, who devastated the eastern parts of Hungary. Helped out Moldavia. Matthias established one of the earliest professional standing armies of medieval Europe, the Black Army of Hungary. Hell yeah! Fucking badass, the Black Army of Hungary, yeah. The Black Army of Hungary, it doesn't get more badass than that. They were only a thing for a few decades, yeah. Matthias recognized the importance and key role of early firearms in the infantry. Every fourth soldier in the Black Army had an arquebus? It's an early one of these. I did know what it was, actually. It's an early one of these. I'll have to go play, what is it, Europa Universalis? I do believe same creators of Hearts of Iron create Europa Universalis. Hey, look at this map. Hungary is pretty huge. Where is the screenshot? There's Hungary in this map. And this game takes place, I think, from like the late Middle Ages on through to the beginning of the colonial era or something, if I'm not mistaken. I'll have to go make Hungary great again, yeah? Back to this Corvinus guy. He reformed the administration of justice, reduced the power of barons, and promoted the careers of talented individuals chosen for their abilities rather than their social statuses. That's good. That's good. That's, you know, you gotta be a big person in the medieval world or coming out of the medieval world to believe in all that shit. Everybody believed it had something to do with blood and royalty and all kinds of nonsense. Matthias patronized art and science, his royal library, Bibliotheca Corviniana, one of the largest, this library had one of the largest collections of books in Europe. With his patronage, Hungary became the first country to embrace the Renaissance from Italy. As Matthias the Just, the monarch who wandered among his subjects in disguise, he remains a popular hero of Hungarian and Slovak folk tales. That's cool. Back in the day, there's no social media or pictures of these people, so the king could just pretend to be a peasant or something. But that's cool. That's badass, yeah? Someday I'm gonna go make a TV series about Matthias and all these years of Hungarian greatness.